Good evening. We should be discussing a very important topic, which is wide complex tachycardia, how to distinguish between ventricular tachycardia and supraventricular tachycardia. This is a very complex and long topic, so I shall be dividing it into multiple parts for ease of learning. So this is part one. So we shall start with a hypothetical case. So you have a 60-year-old male who comes to the ER with a prior history of inferior wall MI, now with syncope. His BP is 60-40 millimeters of mercury. You can have a look at this ECG. It shows a broad complex tachycardia. Now, what do you do? One is you can show your extensive knowledge of ECG and sit and discuss your Brugada algorithm with your colleagues. Two is you can give IV amiodarone. Three is you can give IV adenosine. Or four is you can give a DC shock. Now, this is not a very difficult question to answer. The correct answer is actually you give a DC shock. The point you need to know is when you have a patient who presents with a wide complex tachycardia in shock or hypotension, your aim is not to distinguish whether it's a VT or an SVT. Your aim is to treat the patient, and nothing is as quick and as effective as giving a DC shock. So whether it's SVT in hypotension or a VT in hypotension, the management remains the same. You give a DC shock. All your discussion on whether it's VT or SVT, whether it's you can follow your Brugada algorithm or your Wernicke algorithm. This is not important. What is important is to restore clinical stability to the patient. So a wide complex tachycardia can be a VT or an SVT with aberrancy, which can be a bundle branch block, which is pre-existing, or a rate-induced aberration. That is, at the baseline, they don't have a bundle branch block. When your heart rate exceeds a certain critical threshold, say 130 or 120, they develop a bundle branch block. And last is SVT in the presence of a baseline pre-excitation, like WPW syndrome. So to begin with, clinical correlation. This is the most important part. For example, if you have a patient who has an old anterior wall MI or an old inferior wall MI, and he presents to you with a wide complex tachycardia, you diagnose it as VT, and you would be right in 95% of the cases. Two is, if you have your old ECGs, this is of great help, since you can always compare with old ECGs and see what new findings have set in. But unfortunately, in most of the cases, you don't have your old ECGs, or if you have old ECGs, they are invariably faded off. And the last is, when in doubt, treat as a VT. So if you have a doubt whether it's a VT or an SVT, you always treat as VT. So this is another question, which of the following is true? VT is always hemodynamically unstable, while SVT is hemodynamically stable. VT is always associated with a broad complex rhythm, while SVT is associated with a narrow complex rhythm. VT is always associated with change in axis compared to sinus rhythm ECG. VT has a different morphology when compared to sinus rhythm ECG. So you can see options 3 and 4, you need your previous ECGs. So we shall discuss the answer to this a bit later on in the presentation. This is a 52-year-old anterior wall MI with palpitations. BP is 160, otherwise stable. So you can have a look at the ECG. It shows a fairly narrow complex tachycardia. The QRS would be around 100, and the rate would be around 140 to 150. So is this a VT or an SVT? You can pause the video if required. So by default, an anterior wall MI presenting to you with a wide complex tachycardia, we know it's a VT, but this is not that wide complex, around 100 to 110 milliseconds. So is it a VT or an SVT? So you can compare with your baseline ECG, which is available. You can see it's narrow complex, and the QRS morphology is essentially same across all leads. So you can have a look. And this is actually a ventricular tachycardia. Now, I'm not going into the details of ventricular tachycardia, but I should just mention this. You can start from the third complex. You can see a ventricular complex followed by a retrograde P wave, another ventricular complex followed by a retrograde P wave. If you see the VA distance and compare between these two complexes, you can see the second complex is a longer VA distance and followed by a ventricular complex without any P wave, which is after it. So this cycle keeps on repeating itself. This is actually a ventricular tachycardia with retrograde Wernicke backing, VA conduction. This is not necessary for you to know. This is just to show that this is a ventricular tachycardia. So you have a ventricular tachycardia with a narrow complex, one, and you have the morphology which is essentially same to that which is in the sinus rhythm. So this is just to illustrate a very, very important point. One is all ventricular tachycardias need not be having a broad complex. Similarly, all SVTs need not be having a narrow complex. The width of the QRS complex in a ventricular tachycardia is decided by the site of origin of the tachycardia. So if you can see, along the intraventricular septum is essentially where you have your conduction system. So if you have a focus of origin of VT, which is very close to the septum or the conduction system, it quickly recruits the conduction system. And then it is conducted along normal lines, right? This is in, and so you have narrow complex tachycardia, which is essentially same to that in the sinus rhythm, or narrower, or it's not that wide. Similarly, if you have a ventricle, if you have a VT focus which is far away, say in the lateral wall, there is more muscle to muscle conduction taking place till it reaches the septum, and then it recruits your normal conduction system, and then it follows your normal pathways. So here the complex is likely to be much broader than when the focus is nearer to the conducting system. So the width of the complex is mainly decided by how fast it recruits the conducting system, which is again a function of how close it is to the normal conducting pathway. So a focus of VT which is nearer to the septum, as in this case, or nearer to the conducting pathways, will quickly recruit the conducting system, and you will have a narrower complex tachycardia when compared to a focus which is far away from the conducting system. Thereby you have more muscle to muscle conduction and recruitment to the conduction system late. So you have a broader tachycardia, and you have a morphology which is different from that in sinus rhythm. So if you look at this, if it is very close to the conducting system, you will have essentially the same morphology as in sinus rhythm. While if it is far away from the conducting system, you will have a different morphology than in sinus rhythm. So this is a very important point. So the morphology of the tachycardia as well as the width of the tachycardia is determined by how close the focus is to the conducting system of the heart and how fast it recruits it. So the first point where we used to distinguish whether it's a VT or an SVT is precordial concordance. So precordial concordance is nothing but all chest leads V1 to V6 showing the same polarity. Either all are positive or all are negative. This is your normal heart, where you can see that V1, V2, V3, V4 and V5, V6 in the frontal plane, extending to V9 behind. And you can see the heart, the main focus of the main vector for activation would be around V3 and V4. So you can see that as you go from V1 to V6, the QRS complex keeps on increasing. The R wave polarity keeps on increasing until it peaks around V5. This is your normal polarity. So let's say you have a focus of VT, which arises, say, from the anterior wall of the right ventricle. Okay. And as you know that your chest will be somewhere here, and you'll have your leads V1 to V6 anterior to the right ventricle. So if a focus arises from the anteriormost part of the right ventricle, then all your activation takes place from anterior to posteriorly, because the entire mass of the heart is situated posterior to this focus. So all your chest leads will show a negative complex, because whether you're looking from V1 to V6, all the entire mass of the heart is posterior to the focus of origin, and hence all complexes are going to be negative. Similarly, if you have a VT focus which arises from the posterior part of the LV, say here, then the entire mass of the heart is anterior to this focus. So, and V1 to V6 is going to show a predominantly positive concordance. That is, all complexes are going to be positive from V1 to V6. So now for this to happen, the focus should be either in the anteriormost location or either in the posteriormost location. So if it is there, it is nearly 100% sensitive that it is a VT. So specific, it's a VT, but it's only around 20% sensitive. So sensitivity of around 20% and specificity of nearly 90 to 100%. Again, it depends on the location. So again, a really wide complex QRS complex suggests a VT. So if you have a right bundle branch block with a QRS of more than 140 milliseconds and a left bundle branch with a QRS of more than 160 milliseconds is suggestive of a VT. So basically, if you have a, again, if you have an anterior focus, you have more muscle to muscle conduction till it recruits the conducting system, and hence the width is going to be more. Similarly, you have a posterior focus, you have more muscle to muscle conduction till it reaches the conducting system, and hence the width is going to be more. But one important caveat to keep in mind is if you have a really, really wide QRS complex, say around 240 milliseconds or 260 milliseconds, then you have to keep in your mind whether it's a toxic or a metabolic cause rather than a primary VT. So this is negative precordial concordance. As you can see, all your leads from V1 to V6 have only a negative QRS complex. So this indicates that this is probably originating somewhere in the anterior RV, anterior part of the RV. This is a positive precordial concordance. As you can see, all leads are showing positive QRS complexes from V1 to V6, indicating the focus is somewhere in the posterior most part of the LV. Next is axis change in VT. Now, if you can see, this is a normal focus of normal direction of activation from the right atrium to the right ventricle and left ventricle. It follows this pathway, that is around six axis is usually around 60 degrees. So your normal axis can vary from zero to from minus 30 to 90 degrees. But since the maximum mass of the LV is around 60 degrees, your normal activation will be around 60 degrees. Let's say you have a focus of VT originating here. Now impulse spreads in all directions. Now your focus, the activation is going to be in the opposite direction. So the axis is going to change. So the normal activation will be from up to down, is going to change from down to up. So your axis is going to change in a VT. So a change in axis of more than 40 degrees to the left or right is suggested of ventricular tachycardia. Now again, this also depends on how close it is to the conducting system. So if you have a septal VT, which is recruits your conduction system very fast, it will follow your normal course of activation, and hence the axis may not change. Hence your morphology will also be similar. But if you have a VT which is arising far away from your conducting system of the heart, then your axis is definitely going to change, and a change in more than 40 degrees is likely suggestive of ventricular tachycardia. So here you can see a single lead showing this is normal sinus rhythm, and suddenly you can see a development of VT, and a predominantly negative QRS complex becomes predominantly positive. So you can see the axis change in the single lead itself. This is again a VT. You should start with your, you can see the normal sinus rhythm, and you can see prominent Q waves in 2-3 AVF indicating an old inferior wall MI. And when the VT comes in, the predominantly positive QRS complex in 2-3 AVF, that is indicating that the impulse is coming from top to bottom, that is from your RA to RV, is now becomes predominantly negative, as you can see. 2-3 AVF becomes predominantly negative, indicating a reversal of direction, that the impulse is going from the ventricle upwards. So a focus occurs from below and it is spreading upwards. So you can see a sudden change in axis. When you can see AVR, which is predominantly negative, becomes predominantly positive. So you can see a dramatic change in axis taking place. This is again suggestive of a VT. So the you have also, can I also have bundle branch block and axis discordance. So if you have an RBB morphology with a left axis deviation of more than minus 30 degrees, it's suggestive of a VT. If you have a wide complex tachycardia of an LBB morphology with a right axis deviation of more than 90, it's suggestive of a VT, or whatever right bundle or left bundle, if you have a northwest axis, it's suggestive of a VT. So if your axis is discordant, that is a right bundle with a left axis deviation, or a left bundle with a right axis deviation, or any bundle with a northwest axis. In northwest axis, we cannot say whether it's extreme leftward axis or extreme rightward axis. So bundle branch axis block and axis discordance is indicative of VT. So this can have a right bundle. This is a right bundle branch block with left axis deviation. You can see a right bundle branch block morphology. This is not a true right bundle branch block. You must say this is a right bundle branch morphology with a left axis deviation. As you can see that 1 and AVL become positive. So its axis switched to the left, and 2-3 AVF is predominantly negative. So right bundle branch block with left axis deviation suggestive of VT. Similarly here, you can have a left bundle branch morphology, as you can see, with a rightward axis deviation. As you can see, 1 and AVL has become negative, indicating the axis has switched away from 1 and AVL 2-3 AF have become positive, so the axis has gone towards your inferior leads. So a left bundle branch block with a right axis deviation is also suggestive for VT. If it's an SVT with bundle branch, pre-existing bundle branch block, then the axis is usually normal or concordant. So if your left bundle branch block is associated with the left axis and the right bundle branch block is associated with the right axis deviation. The last is, if you look at AVR lead algorithm. So if you look at your normal heart, your entire muscle mass is situated in your apex of the LV, and this is around 60 degrees. So your main axis would be around 60, close to around 60 degrees, as this corresponds to your maximal muscle mass. Suppose your axis is around minus 150 degrees, which is around AVR, it indicates a grossly abnormal axis because it's completely diametrically opposite to your normal axis deviation. So a normal axis of around 60 degrees will look that you have a very tall R wave in 2 and 3 and around AVF, as these are your axes directed in this direction. And since the axis away from AVL, you have small QRS in AVL, and you have a predominantly negative QRS in AVR. Let's say you have a focus which arises from here. Then your VT focus arising from here would cause a switch in axis. That is, instead of a normal activation coming from, say, from top the RA to down towards 60 degrees, you have a focus of activation which occurs from the ventricle and upwards. So your axis also switches, and an SVT. So if you look at AVR, then the SVT will have base to apex activation, and AVR will not show an initial R. And if you look at AVR and VT, since the VT has a apex to base activation, that is from the ventricular apex, it is activated straight to the base, you can have an initial R wave in AVR, since the impulse goes towards AVR. So when the QRS complex in lead AVR is entirely positive, the tachycardia originates close to the apex of the ventricle with a wave of depolarization moving upwards towards the base of the heart. So if you have a pure positive R wave in AVR, that is without an initial Q wave, you can say the VTs or the VT focuses around the apex of the heart, so that it directly directs towards AVR, and you get a pure positive wave in AVR without a Q wave. Let's look at SVT with bundle branch block. Now with SVT with bundle branch block and AVR lead is somewhere around here, the vector is initially goes downwards and then it spreads via muscle to muscle conduction. So the initial downward vector would be picked up as a small Q wave initially. So this is the AVR Verrique algorithm. So you have a tall R wave in AVR without an initial Q wave. This is called as a dominant R wave. So no Q wave with a tall R wave in AVR is indicative of a VT. And if you have a prominent initial Q wave followed by an R wave, this is indicative of a SVT. Again, this indicates that the conduction is taking place through the conducting system. And when the conducting system faces away from directions away from AVR, you get the Q wave. So a tall R wave without a Q wave is indicative of a VT, while an initial Q wave followed by an R wave is indicative of an SVT. Again, these are not absolute rules. If you have a tall R wave, then it's usually indicative of a VT, which is arising somewhere from the apex of the heart. So this is the initial positivity of AVR. You can see a white complex tachycardia, and you can see a dominant R wave in AVR without a Q wave. This is a supraventricular tachycardia. You can see that there is an initial Q followed by a R wave. So this is an indicator. So this is a favorite question which has been asked in exams. Is given, you're only given one lead to find out whether it's an SVT or a VT. What lead would you choose? The answer is AVR. You choose AVR. So another rule is, if you have a previous ECG with the ventricular premature complex, and if the tachycardia morphology is similar to the VPC, it is a VT. If the tachycardia morphology is similar to the sinusoidal beat, then it is a SVT. So this is it's actually an RVOT VPC. So you can see that there's a left bundle branch morphology for the VPC with positive waves in 2-3 AF, indicating that it's originating somewhere from the RV outflow. So just focus on this beat. and this is your sinus beat. If you look at the morphology, now we have ventral tachycardia, you have a white complex tachycardia whose morphology is similar to that of the ventricular premature complex beat. So 2-3 AVF, you can have a look here, and you have a similar morphology to that of the ventricular premature complex. So if you have a ventricular premature complex in sinus rhythm, and if you have the tachycardia morphology mimicking that of the ventricular premature complex, then it's a VT. If the tachycardia morphology mimics that of the sinus rhythm complex, then it's an SVT. Then another important point is evidence of independent atrial activity. Now, when you have the when you have a VT and the ventricle is beating at say 180 or 200 per minute, there is also going to be evidence of atrial activity. So if you can prove the evidence of atrial activity at a time when the ventricle is beating very fast, you can diagnose it's a ventricular tachycardia. Now you can diagnose with direct evidence as in AV dissociation or indirect evidence as in capture of fusion beats. So AV dissociation. So when the ventricle is beating very fast, you can, even though ventricle will be beating very fast, say at 180 or 200, the atrium is also going to beat normally, say around 80 or 90. So, and you can occasionally get these atrial spikes in the ventricular complexes. And this AV dissociation is a hallmark of VT with a specificity approaching 100%, however with low sensitivity. So you can detect only in 20 to 50% of all VTs. So this is is an example of a VT with AV dissociation. If you look, you have a ventricular complex, and you have a P wave here, and the ventricular complex runs through. So if you can trace the atrial complexes, here you have an atrial complex followed by here. The next ventricular complex is going to be somewhere around here. It's probably buried in the QRS complex, followed by another one here, followed by another one just buried in the QRS complex, followed by another one here, another one here, another one here, followed by here. So you can see that the atrial complexes are marching through the ventricular rhythm, and the ventricular rate, the V rate, is faster than the atrial rate. This is indicative of a ventricular tachycardia. That is, you have AV dissociation with a V rate faster than the atrial rate. So this is one of the hallmarks of VT. And this is another example of an AV dissociation where you can see the atrial rate marches through the ventricular complexes. So you have a regular PP rhythm, you have a regular RR rhythm, you have variable PR intervals, but the atrial rate is faster than the ventricular rate. Now this is a complete heart block. The complete heart block is you have regular PP interval, regular RR interval, varying PR interval indicative of an AV dissociation, and the atrial rate is much faster than the ventricular rate. So this is a typical complete heart block. In VT with AV dissociation, the ventricular rate is faster than the atrial rate. Next is presence of capture beats and fusion beats, which are indirect evidences of atrial activity. So capture beats occur when the SA node transiently captures the ventricle. So when you have the ventricle might be beating at say 180 to 200, and a perfectly timed sinus or P wave can enter and capture the ventricles. So this is rare but occasionally occurs. So occurs when a sinoatrial node transiently captures the ventricle in the midst of AV dissociation to produce a QRS complex of narrow duration. So how does it look? It looks like a normal sinus rhythm complex preceded by a P wave. Next is fusion beat. It's also known as Dressler's beat. Occurs when the sinus and the ventricular beat coincides to produce a hybrid complex. So you have a rhythm coming from the RA down, and you have a rhythm coming from the ventricle upwards. They meet somewhere in the middle and produce a fusion complex. Again, this should be perfectly timed. So how does it look? A classical description is it looks midway between the sinus complex and the ventricular tachycardia complex. However, practically, it assumes any configuration other than the configuration of the QRS complex during normal sinus rhythm or during tachycardia. So they usually occur in a morphology which is different from that of the tachycardia complex and different from that of the sinus rhythm complex. If they have a P, it is usually having a shorter PR interval since the distance the sinus beat has to travel shorter. So another point is they are usually seen at the beginning or at the end of the ventricular tachycardia. So again, so let's say, so this is your normal sinus beat. We're not sure whether it's a capture beat or a normal sinus beat because we don't have a preceding QRS complexes. Now, this is your ventral tachycardia beat. And as you can see, this complex is different from this complex and this complex. This is actually your fusion beat. So it has some of the features. If you look at it, it is different from that of the sinus beat as well as the PT beat and is preceded by a PR. And this PR is much shorter than this PR. This is your classical fusion beat. Again, this is an example of another fusion beat. As you can see, it occurs at the beginning of the VT. So you have sinus beat. You have a fusion beat, which is with a shorter PR interval, with a different morphology to that of the VT beat or the sinus beat. So short PR and a complex which is different from that of the both the sinus beat and the VT beat. Again, here you have sinus rhythm, and here you have the VT. Here you have two complexes, again with shorter PR intervals, with a morphology which is different to that of the sinus beat or the ventral tachycardia with shorter PR intervals, again occurring at the start of the VT. Again, you have ventral tachycardia going on. Here you have sinus beats. You can see that this is probably a capture beat. And again, the ventral tachycardia resumes. So we have what is a P followed by a QRS complex. You can see Q waves. This is probably indicative of an old MI, which might be the source of your VT. And this looks like your normal sinus beat. So it's a capture beat. And this complex, which is encircled in red, does not have the morphology of that of the sinus beat or the VT beat. Hence, this is a fusion complex. So a fusion complex or a capture beat indicate that there is evidence of independent atrial activity, so indicator of a VT. So again, just to hammer home the points, you have a run of VT, you have a capture beat here, and you have a fusion beat here. Again, this does not have morphology of both, either the VT or the sinus. So this is a fusion beat. Again, this is a fusion capture beat and a VT showing a capture beat and a fusion beat. So the last point, which I should say, which of the following is true? VT is always hemodynamically unstable while SVT is hemodynamically stable. This is a point which is generally always got wrong by students. That is, VT is always hemodynamically unstable. You can have hemodynamically stable VTs, as you can also have hemodynamically unstable SVTs. VT is always associated with a broad complex rhythm, while SVT is associated with a narrow complex rhythm. This again is wrong because you can have narrow complex VTs when it's very close to your conducting system, and you can have broad complex SVTs when it's associated with pre-excitation or bundle branch blocks. VT is always associated with a change in axis when compared to sinusoidal ECGs. This is generally true. However, the exception is if you have a focus which is close to your septum or conducting system, and it recruits the conducting system very fast, it mimics your normal sinus rhythm ECG. VT has a different morphology when compared to sinus rhythm ECG. This is also generally true, but however, if it is very close to the conducting system, then you can have similar morphologies. So next is morphological criteria to distinguish between VT and SVT. Again, this is very complex, so I had put it in another class. So this ends the presentation. So please like, share, and subscribe, and press the bell icon to get notified when another video pops up.